Hey guys, James Doyle here, and we are here at Legendary Motorcar, and I'm actually here with my good friend Peter. And Peter, it's great to be here with you. Great to see you again.
Glad we were able to make it out.
Thank you so much. Now, you know, I've always, you know, I love the collection that's here and all the different cars, but I think something that's a lot more important to cover is the people behind those cars, because the cars don't make the people make the car.
Sure.
So tell us a little bit about the history behind the business, how it started, and, you know, what it was like, you know, from a family aspect to you.
So I started in 85 as a business, but I really started fixing cars when I was 15 years old. My dad was a welder, so he had some equipment at home, taught me how to weld. I bought my first car when I was 15. I fixed it in the driveway, painted it in the driveway, sold it for, $2,800. I think I paid $200 for it and thought this is way better than delivering newspapers.
Absolutely. Yeah. So once you started, you know, the company, and how did you guys progress, and, you know, what happened throughout the years up until now?
I think with any sort of business, you have to be passionate about it. And since I was, you know, 15, I've always loved cars. And then after I finished school, I didn't want to work in a bank. I didn't want to kind of do the traditional thing. So I thought, I'm going to give myself a year to fire up a business, see how it works. We bought and sold 60 cars that year. I hired my first employee, and he actually just retired this year, so
it was
2 years later, and just grew the business. But it was all about the cars and the people. And it's interesting to say that, you know, the people, the best part of our business are our customers. They're all interesting people. They're all, you know, successful in their own way. You know, to be able to buy a collector car, you have to, you know, have some sort of success, and they're very interesting people to talk to.
So now, what's it like for you being, I guess, the father of this business, to see it really grown up? It has proven to be an extremely successful, you know, car collection and an extremely successful business. What's it like to you seeing it all grown up?
I think it's a bunch of people that work here make it successful. You know, obviously hiring the right people is really important. But the other thing too is, you know, the customers and the passion for what we're doing is really important. And if you have all of those things combined and a little bit of business savvy and a lot of luck, because like I said, when I started the business, I started at the kind of the perfect time between 85 and 90, it was idiot proof. If you bought a car, you made money on it, and if you bought wrong, 6 months worth of time fixed it. So if I'd started in 1990 as opposed to 85, you know, we had a big decline, could have been out of business in a year. So I think luck has a lot to do with it when you enter a business, when you, you know, really started to get full stride in a business, it makes a difference. And then the people you hire, it's all about people.
Absolutely, yeah. And, you know, with you in your business, right, you have gotten a lot of cars, but what's the most notable car that you can remember, you know, in the entire history of the business that you can look back at and say, you know, that was the most exciting part of this business or something like that?
I would have to say it's probably the flip-top Cobra or the prototype Ken Miles car or prototype 427. There's only one in the world. Really special car. We chased the car for quite a while and then did a restoration that's, you know, over the top in the sense of originality. We hunted down the motor. It took 2 years to get the motor, to find the motor. Mm-hmm. And it's just a really special car. So I think a lot of the excitement about it is, you know, the chase for the car. And then it's like a treasure hunt trying to find all the pieces.
Absolutely.
And then, you know, there's art involved in trying to restore it back to the way it was in day one. And then you have the history. What made the car so important in the first place?
Absolutely. And we're in front of a really incredible GT40 here. So tell us a little bit about the car that's behind us.
So this is one of the five original prototypes. It's GT105. Two were destroyed in period, so only three are left. Two are in the Shelby Museum. And this is the only one left in its kind of period livery with the white and the blue and the stripe up the center. It's also got early bodywork on it, which the other two, they have the later version of the bodywork on it.
Absolutely.
But what's really cool, too, is Ford just decided to make this the last Heritage Edition is basically a takeoff on 105. So their first one was the 66 Le Mans winner, then the 67, then the 68, 69, then the Daytona winner with Ken Miles. And this is the last one they're going to do, which is kind of paying tribute to the beginning of the whole GT40 program.
Absolutely. Sounds cool. So, no. In your collection, and out of all of the cars you've ever had, well, you've gone through a lot of clients. Do you remember, you know, your favorite, most notable, I guess, you know, people and clients that you can remember and say they had a cool story with that car?
I think there's a lot of guys, and the mix is from guys that have bought cars from brand new and have, you know, looked after those cars and haven't put miles on it. And then you have other guys that raced the car, beat the crap out of the cars, threw it aside, you know, like it was just not worth anything. And those cars end up being really valuable. So I wouldn't say there's one individual or one guy that stands out, but every collector is unique in its own, in his own way or her own way. And I find it, like I said, it's fascinating talking to the people and their stories. So, you know, one guy starts with nothing and, you know, ends up building a multi-billion dollar business and gets into cars late in life. And then other guys start, like yourself, really early in life and build into something that, you know, they're following their passion. So to me, it's not one story that stands out. They're all interesting.
So now, as you said before, it's, you know, it's kind of like a treasure hunt for some of these cars. So what's it like to buy and sell, you know, the different cars and really get to the treasure, I guess you could say?
I guess, you know, the fun is the chase. One is identifying what you're after. And then secondly, figuring out who has it. Sometimes it's pretty easy and other times it takes a bunch of time. And then figuring out how to buy it. And a lot of that is timing. You know, people will say it's never for sale. Well, never is a long time. And I think what you're going to find is usually people sell for a variety of reasons. You know, there's you know, wanting to clean up estates. There's people that want to just change faces. There's people that have to sell it. They go through different life crises and things like that. So timing is the big thing, and staying on top of people, like calling them every 6 months or calling them every year and just making that connection. So when they're ready to sell, you're there. And that's probably half the battle on trying to buy really unique cars. I mean, if you're out trying to buy a 4 GT, you know, an 05 4 GT, there's 05 06s, there's 4,000 built. You can pick up any publication basically or go on the internet and find one. That's a different animal than trying to buy something really special. Those ones, it's pretty simple to find the cars. It's not really a treasure hunt.
Absolutely. Now, something I find really cool is that this is, you know, I guess we can call you the first generation of the business, but as it's moving on, you know, your children is kind of, you know, taking over, doing a lot here as well, and they're a big part of the business as well. So tell us a little bit about what they're doing and stuff.
I have two boys, and they both kind of do their own thing, and they're both crazy about cars. They both love racing, which is great. You know, I'm really lucky to have them coming into business. And what's interesting is how they've changed how I look at the business. When you start a business from zero, I think you look at it differently than if you're kind of thrust into it or you come into it at a different stage. And they look at it probably in a smarter way, where I'm looking at smaller deals and they're looking at bigger deals and less volume. So it's interesting their mindset on what we should be doing. And it's also interesting, you know, they have a step back and a different perspective, and they say, you know, where are we doing well? Where aren't we doing well? What do we like doing? Yeah. What don't we like doing? And what do we want to focus on? So it's less about survival and more about, again, going to what is the real passion.
Absolutely, yeah. And you are also, you and both your son, Gary, is heavily involved with NASCAR. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, all three of us actually just did the race.
Oh, really?
This weekend. It was a doubleheader. So I ran Saturday, Ryan ran the Sunday, and Gary ran both of the days. So it was good.
So NASCAR really is a big family sport. So tell us about that.
I think all racing is a family sport. when, you know, the kids got into go-kart racing, it's a great way to spend time together. You're basically at the racetrack for 2-3 days. Sometimes you're camping there, sometimes you aren't. It gives them responsibility when a 7-year-old gets into a kart and, you know, is beat and bashing, and, you know, there's emotion, there's controlling your emotions, there's sportsmanship, there's helping out getting the carts ready. So there's a lot of things going on. And then there's also the risk reward. You know, are you willing to stick it in and end up on your lid? So you're making a bunch of decisions at a young age. And I think from for us, it was great. You know, we spent from the time they were 7 until they were 16 karting, you know, 4, 5, 6, 8 weekends in summer. It was just a great way to spend time with them.
Now, I know that karting really builds, you know, character and, you know, a lot of different discipline and other hand skills into youth. So, you know, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, definitely. Anytime, you know, kids can get their hands dirty and understand how things work and, you know, look at it from an engineering point of view. And, you know, they're not looking at it from an engineering point of view, but they understand, you know, if we move the seat up higher, we're going to get more lean in it. We're going to be able to pick up that one tire. You know, there, if we use, you know, different axles, we're going to have different handling characteristics. So they're already thinking about things at a really young age.
And getting a really good head start, right?
Right.
So now we're here with Gary. Gary, it's great to be here with you. So tell us a little bit just about your career and what you've been doing so far and how much fun it is to, you know, really be picking up your dad's torch.
Well, I mean, you know, it's great. It's any kid's dream come true to be able to work in the family business that they enjoy and love and grow up here. Obviously, having such a great role model, you know, where I really fell in love with the business or kind of the area is racing go-karts. Like I was saying, growing up racing go-karts, being a competitive guy, and then kind of moving forward, taking that into doing more and more NASCAR racing and trying to build that racing career. And then, you know, buying and selling some cars, definitely starting when I was 15 and 16 and just building that.
So now a lot of people can, watch some previous videos, on the, you know, legendary, Motorcar YouTube channel. Tell us about that.
When we kind of said, okay, we're finished doing TV, we did 20 years of TV. We thought, you know, the future is really YouTube or that sort of media, and you know, Gary was saying, let's do one clip a week. We have control over it. You know, we can decide how much we want to shoot, how much we don't want to shoot. We don't have a network saying, hey, we want this sort of format. We can be more freewheeling.
So now I think it's really cool to see the different cars that you guys are showing, the collection of cars that people can come in and see. Because, you know, as you said, these aren't in a lot of people's backyards, but people that do have some of these cars, a lot of time, sometimes lock them up and don't show them that much. So to see you guys so open with showing the different cars, I think is also really, really cool. But let's get into what you guys are doing for the local hospitals, because you guys are giving a lot to them, aren't you?
Well, I mean, yeah, that's just like what I was saying at the front door. Just everyone who comes in gives a donation, and then we'll match it and go to different charities, different hospitals in the area. And we're fortunate to be able to show these cars. You know, a lot of those big collectors, they've got, you know, big time jobs that are very demanding on their time, and they want to have a private life. But this is the business, so we have the opportunity to buy and sell these cars and show them to the public.
Absolutely. So now let's talk a little bit about both of your favorite scenes from Ford versus Ferrari.
I think one of the favorite scenes is, you know, the relationship between Ken and Peter Miles in the movie, where, you know, he's telling them what it's like to drive at Le Mans and how special that perfect lap is. And I think that's pretty cool.
Absolutely. And that's kind of just like the two of you, which is really cool to see how, you know, the relationship between the two of you started a long time ago and has really evolved. So that's cool to see.
Hang on, I got a question for James. What was your favorite scene?
My favorite scene, and this is actually, I knew this as soon, while I'm watching the movie, I saw this scene and I said nothing can top this, and it was my favorite before the movie even finished. And it's when Henry Ford broke down and started crying after he got a test drive in the GT40 for the first time, talking about how he wished his father would be there to be able to see that. And I think seeing that scene was, it really showed the passion that he had and then what he wished his father could have seen. I think that really topped it for me. But again, there was so many, you know, great scenes, and what you said before about how it's this whole storyline, and you know, you can't really pick a particular scene. I think that really, you know, is just the backstory behind Henry and his father, and then going up to that moment when he broke down inside the car. I think that was really cool to see. You know, I want to thank you so much, Peter, for really retaining history, you know, sharing it with the community, and it has been great to talk to both of you. Thank you so much, Peter, and thank you as well, Gary, and your brother. He couldn't be here with us today, but you know what, that's all good. And I think it's going to be really cool. And here we'll show some footage now of the Dream Garage. We'll see you guys soon. Bye-bye.